Friends, welcome as we gather on this Thanksgiving Sunday to show our gratitude for the abundant grace that God gives to us in this world. And we're always glad that you have joined us with us. We know that we live in challenging times with all that's going on in the world, but we pray that indeed that this is a time where we can give thanks for the simple blessings of the past year, and may the time that you worship with us be full of love, and may you say that it was glad to have joined us today. Of always, our life and ministry now, and my contact information is there. Celebrations, we have no celebrations, but just want to note that today's order of service is given to the glory of God and in loving memory of Reverend Roland Wells, and is ever remembered by Brenda, Roberta, and families. And also, celebrations, I don't have any right now, but we do have some prayers of concern, and we lift those each and every Sunday to those known unto us and to those known only unto God. And know that we pray for you as well, you who are joining us online. And we give thanks to God that we have this opportunity to be able to offer worship to you in your homes or wherever you are. And just a note that if you're in the area or in any area, actually, supporting the food bank is very important, because food banks now are finding that their visitations and people coming in need of support are up by about 40%. So we ask you, you know, whenever you have opportunity, to give a little to the food bank. And a note as well that we have a gospel concert in this area, in this church, in Trinity United, on October the 25th at 7 p.m. And we ask you to come and enjoy an evening of gospel in song, fellowship, and of course, a cup of tea afterwards. And November the 16th, all the United Churches up and down the Trinity Shore will be joining together, all six of them, from Dunville, Grace United, from Greens Harbor, Hearts Content, Norman's Cove, White Way, and Whitbourne, will be joining together at Greens Harbor United on the 16th of November to kick off the 100th anniversary celebrations of the United Church of Canada. And it's going to be a day of music, a day of singing, a day of potluck, and also ending in a special worship celebration for that evening. So let us truly make it a united day, and come and join us for the day. And I think that's all of our announcements. So now let us join our hearts together as we joyfully sing, "I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad." Let us sing with Yvonne, our intro today. And friends, today, as we normally do, we light our Christ candle as a reminder that God goes before us, God is within us, and God is around us. And God calls us to light the way for peace and harmony in this world. And for that we say, thanks be to God. But today we also offer prayers for peace in Palestine, for the Palestinians, and for the Israelis, that a peaceful resolution may be found so that all God's people can work together. We pray as well for folks around the world who are in torment, because we know that there are many who are affected by the war in Gaza. And we also have our folks to the south who are experiencing a lot of trauma with the hurricanes and the devastation. So these candles today, with Christ leading the way, may it bring peace to our world. Thank you, God, for the blessing of your peace. Amen. Please join me now for our call to worship, and it's printed in your order of service. Come, you thankful people, come. Come on this day when we give thanks and praise for God's continual blessings. We come with thankful hearts and the assurance that comes through our faith in God. Come, be still and know that the God of peace is here. For it is in these quiet, sacred moments where we may hear whispers of God's call. We come longing for wisdom and peace to fill our spirits. Let us lift our voices in prayer and song. Let our thankfulness be raised. Let us pray together. Holy God, on this Thanksgiving Sunday, as the landscape is painted with reds and golds, we are filled with gratitude. Your limitless love, found in all creation, calls us to give thanks. We have been blessed with so many gifts from you: love experienced in family, warm fellowship within our faith community, and the comfort of your holy presence. We gather from far and near with hearts overflowing, ready to commune with you. Prepare us by this worship for even greater praise and service. In Jesus' name, amen. And now let us join our hearts together as we sing an old hymn. From shortest hymn goes way back to our first old hymnary. Voices United, 227, for the fruit of all creation, thanks be to God. For the gifts to every nation, thanks be to God. Let us sing that together.
The fruits of all creation, thanks be to God. For his gifts to every nation, thanks be to God. For the plowing, sowing, reaping, silent growth while we are sleeping, needs in earth safe keeping, thanks be to God. In the just reward of labor, God's will is done. In the help we give our neighbor, God's will is done. Sharing, God's will is done. For the harvest of the Spirit, thanks be to God. For the good we all inherit, thanks be to God. Found us, thanks be to God.
We just prayed that throughout the week we need to hear whispers of God's call. And we know that sometimes those whispers from day to day become silent. And it's in that spirit that we pray together our prayer of confession. And it's printed in our order of service. Let us pray. Holy God, we confess that many times we have wasted your most generous gifts and have forgotten to be thankful. Often we turn aside from our neighbors in need, while we ourselves experience plenty. Forgive us these moments when we have fallen short of your expectations. Let's take a moment in silent prayer. And continuing together, hear our heartfelt prayers, renew our spirit, so we may serve and love you more closely. Amen. And friends, there's always an assurance of pardon. Pardon is God's gracious gift to those whose hearts and minds are in Christ Jesus. Thanks be to God. In Christ Jesus, we are forgiven. Amen. Teddy, I know it's Thanksgiving and you're excited, and I am too, aren't you? Yeah. Oh, hi, boys and girls. Teddy and I are here, and he's listening to his favorite song, and he loves it. He said that at Thanksgiving, we are to let our little light shine. Sure we are. Okay. You know what? That's Teddy's favorite song, and he'd like to listen to it. Now, you want to listen to it with him? Sure you do. Let's listen, and maybe if you know the words, you can sing along with Teddy. I hope you did too. Well, we just hope that you have a happy Thanksgiving. Oh, yes. Okay. Well, we'll have a prayer. Okay, let us pray. Head, put our hands together and close our eyes. Loving God, thank you for putting your light within us and allowing us to shine. Amen. Have a great Thanksgiving, everyone. Bye.
And before I invite our sacred scriptures to be shared, let us seek God's blessing upon our hearing. Loving God, we gather, thankful for the many gifts that you have given us, but most of all, the gift of your word that guides us and watches over us and helps us to live more closely, to follow the example of Jesus Christ. Bless our hearing and understanding that indeed we may truly follow and be your disciples. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Our first reading today comes from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, chapter 9, reading verses 6 to 15. Reading from the Newly Revised Standard Version. Generosity encouraged. The point is this: the one who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and the one who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each of you must give as you have made up your mind, not regretfully or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to provide you with every blessing in abundance, so that by always having enough of everything, you may share abundantly in every good work. As it is written, He scatters abroad, He gives to the poor, His righteousness endures forever. He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way for your great generosity, which will produce thanksgiving to God through us. For the rendering of this ministry not only supplies the needs of the saints, but also overflows with many thanksgivings to God. Through the testings of this ministry, you glorify God by your obedience to the confession of the gospel of Christ, and by the generosity of your partnership with them and with all others, while they long for you and pray for you because of the surpassing grace of God that He has given you. Thanks be to God for this indescribable gift. The word of God for us this day. Thanks be to God. Our responsive reading, Psalm 126, is found in Voices United 850. Let us share responsibly. When God brought Zion's captives home, it seemed to us like a dream. But then our mouths were full of laughter, our tongues uttered shouts of joy. Then they said among the nations, God has done great things for them. Truly, God has done great things for us, and therefore we rejoice. We praise the one who gave the growth with voices full and strong. Restore our fortunes, O God, as streams refresh the Negev. Those who sow in tears shall reap with shouts of joy. Those who go out weeping, carrying seed for sowing, shall come home with songs of joy, bringing in their sheaves. We praise the one who gave the growth with voices full and strong. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Our gospel reading today comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 17, reading verses 11 to 19. Jesus cleanses 10 men with a skin disease. On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee. As he entered a village, 10 men with a skin disease approached him. Keeping their distance, they called out, saying, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. When he saw them, he said to them, Go and show yourselves to the priests. And as they went, they were made clean. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. He prostrated himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. And he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus asked, Were not 10 men made clean? So where are the other 9? Did none of them return to give glory to God except this foreigner? Then he said to them, Get up and go on your way. Your faith has made you well. Friends, the Gospel of Christ according to Luke. Thanks be to God.
Thank you for the reading of those scriptures. And before I begin our meditation, let us pray. O Lord, we pray, speak in the calming and the quietness of our minds, and in the longing of our hearts, by the words that we share and the thoughts that we form, as we meditate upon your holy word this day, may what we share be acceptable in your sight, O Lord. Amen. Today around the world, as we've said, is Thanksgiving Day. And tomorrow, Monday, is a holiday. For people all across Canada, they'll celebrate Thanksgiving. But Thanksgiving, what is it? What is Thanksgiving now in our world today? For us in Canada, it's a time to give thanks for the harvest of what we may have planted or gathered. Pumpkins, vegetables in our gardens, apples, berries maybe that we have picked, jars of preserves or maybe pickles that we have, or jam, and some of them have been brought and shared here today. And we give thanks for the beauty of nature, the multicolored leaves. We give thanks for the corn and for the grapevines and others, and all the blessings of the past year. But it's also a time for us, especially in Newfoundland and Labrador, when families gather over bounteous feasts of turkey with all the trimmings. And that's all good. But also, at this time, we need to reflect and be cautious with what we think about what God has given us. And that our feasting, yes, it's right to celebrate and share the bounty of the earth, but it's also right to express appreciation and to rejoice over the goodness of God. So our thanksgiving today may need a checking, depending upon our attitude and our approach to life and to what God has done for us and continues to do. Because thanksgiving is more than one day tip of the hat. Or in that case, if it's only a one day thing and going away feeling, well, we had a good time, thanks, that was good, we deserve that, we may only be like the lepers in our stories today. The rest of the lepers were happy over what they had received, yet forgot to return, and as an act of faith, to give thanks. And Jesus expected much better from the other lepers, and I guess God calls us to much better as well. Because God calls us not only to a momentous day of thanksgiving, but to a life of thanks living, for thanks living is a way of life. It's an attitude of the heart that reminds us that all good things and all good people we have in this life and those we encounter are gifts from God. A gift, it's a gift and a blessing to be with family and friends if we choose. Last week, Erwin and I went to the gathering place to drop off much needed coats and mittens and hats and sweaters. And as we entered, my heart was stirred with the images before me of folks for various reasons, whether mental health, homelessness, and I'm sure some addiction issues, but they seemed remotely connected from society. The attendant who came to help us bring in the things we had said many of them had no family, no home, and they were unable to live independently on their own due to medical issues. And it was easy to see that those who came to the gathering place for clothing, food, and community were those who were like the lepers, much needed and much feeling much outside of the realm of everyday life, like outcasts. But I witnessed how the attendants conversed with them, shared laughter with them. And I don't think it was just laughter and conversation, but most of all, love and a sense of belonging. And as we brought forward what we had to share, the mittens, the coats, and the caps, my thoughts came to our scriptures today, who, like this group of lepers, because of their condition, didn't have the privilege of many of the blessings that most of the people had in their day, or most of the people have in our day, because many are shunned by society. And in our Luke's reading, we hear how Jesus, just outside the village, he meets this group of outcasts, this group of lepers, who are also shunned because of their condition and forced to live outside their villages and outside the village gate because they weren't allowed social contact with the clean members of society. In fact, if one person caught it in the family and had a condition at that time and considered incurable, they were declared a leper. They were banned from society and banned from family connections. And the person with this infection disease had to wear torn clothes. They had to let themselves become unkempt and uncared for and cover the lower part of their face and they had to cry out when anyone came within a certain legal distance. They had to cry out, unclean, unclean, to keep others from coming near. Talk about social distancing. So you can imagine the joy they had when Jesus, filled with compassion and mercy, reached out to them, stopped to talk with them, and healed all 10. They must have been overjoyed as Jesus sent them to the priest to declare them healed of leprosy and able to go back to re-enter society again. But when we read on, we find that even though all 10 lepers were cleaned from their disease, only one came all the way back to Jesus, praising God for Jesus' mercy in healing him. In humility, the thankful leper throws himself at Jesus' feet, and Jesus receives thanks graciously and said to him, "Your faith has made you well." And the thankful leper must have credited Jesus as God's instrument for his healing. And sometimes, unless we know the context or the political and the religious culture of the day, we may have missed one important word in this passage. Why did Luke's gospel say that the one who returned was a Samaritan and not pointed out among the others? We do know that in Jesus' day, the Jewish people of Galilee and Judea shunned the Samaritans, viewing them as a mixed race who practiced an impure and half-pagan religion. So even before this man developed leprosy, he was shunned and looked down upon. Yet it was him, the Samaritan, who returned, giving thanks to God for his healing. A Samaritan of all people, the foreigner, the social and religious outcast, the one who would not be counted under the elected, but judged as a heretic by most people of his time, epitomizes this kind of godly life and attitude that everyone in Jesus' time was called to display, and who we are called to display today. He demonstrated that a faith that lays hold on God is one that cannot remain silent in response to what God had done to his life, and one that publicly and spontaneously and joyfully directs thanksgivings toward God. In our scripture today, we realize being grateful, though, was not a precondition for being cleaned by Jesus. All the lepers find themselves cleansed as they showed themselves to the priest, but were they healed? They were cleansed, but were they healed? However, the Samaritan turns around and comes back. And in Luke, as in the New Testament in general, whenever we hear the word turning around, it's more or less a description of the believer's actions heart than a description of his action, as it carries a deep theological meaning. It describes a movement of the person's whole being initiated by God's graceful work. It's a redirection toward God. And Jesus' words, "Your faith has made you well," refers therefore not to the medical cleansing of the Samaritan, but to the holistic healing of this human being. Karl Barth, a very profound theologian, was fond of saying that the basic response to God is gratitude. It's not fear or trembling. It's not guilt or dread, but thanksgiving. He said, "What else can we say to what God gives us but stammer out our praise?" And C.S. Lewis, another well-known theologian, when he explored his newfound faith, he observed something that I think we need to take note of today, that the connection between being grateful and having gratitude and a person's personal well-being is significant. And I quote his words. "I noticed," he said, "how the humblest and at the same time the most balanced minds praise the most, while the cranks and the misfits and the malcontents
praise the least. Praise, he said, almost seems to be the inner health that's made audible. Our human response of thanksgiving, therefore, is not only something we should do, but is something that for us is also a sense of personal well-being. It's the most joyful thing also that we can do. At least if we take it seriously, every time we prayed the Eucharistic prayer, which we did last Sunday, Communion Sunday, it says that God is with us, God goes before us, and God is the God of peace. And Jesus says, your faith has made you well. And it's one of those verses from scriptures, though, that has done much harm, because we know that many have who have given joyful thanks to God have prayed and yet not recovered from illness or an accident. And even when many don't recover, they think, well, maybe my prayers weren't good enough. Maybe my prayers weren't hard enough. And some feel maybe their prayers were inferior and that because they didn't work. But this scripture today seems to indicate that the problem is not with our prayer, but our perceptions of our faith. Many think of faith as being a cause and effect. You pray something, and it either happens or it doesn't happen. But Luke's Jesus is pointing to a more profound understanding of faith. Here we see the actual healing of this leper is almost a sideline event, as Jesus does it without fanfare. We don't know where the nine of the 10 lepers go, but we do know this one, the foreigner, the despised one, that comes back to bow down at Jesus' feet to worship and give thanks, his faith has made him well. And it's difficult to know what tone Jesus uses. You know, when he asks, where are the others? Was he angry? Was he flabbergasted? What he does make clear, though, is that this most unlikely, this double outcast, has been embraced by grace. Get up and go, he says. Your faith has made you well. And the grateful leper's wellness runs beyond the physical. The other nine go on their way to a happy life, what they are thinking. Their failure to thank Jesus, though, reveals a sort of, well, that worked, didn't it? The way we called out to him. And so we deserve it. We deserve to be healed. But I hear Jesus telling me not to be concerned with the quantity of my faith, whether I have enough to make my prayers work, as if my faith were a matter of cause and effect. Rather, I think Jesus is teaching me about the nature of my faith. To have faith is to live it, and to live it is to give thanks. And it's a living life of gratitude that constitutes a living life of faith. This is the grateful sort of faith that has made this man from Samaria truly and deeply well. One could almost say that faith and gratitude are two words for the same thing. Practicing gratitude is to practice faith. And if faith is not something we have, but something we do, or something we live, then in living, we express our complete trust in God. How then can we not practice gratitude when we know that God is the giver of all good gifts, holds all life in providential care? And when we practice gratitude, we find that faith is given in abundance and overflowing. Friends, as we offer this meditation today, it touches everyone, every life. Every life, the healed and the sick, the outcast and the stranger, the delivered and the still bound, the successful and those who are out of work. If prayers of thanks are a part of our soul's healing and deliverance from our physical circumstances of the one who prays, that becomes less important. It's the thankfulness that saves the grateful leper. And such thankfulness is available to everyone in every circumstance. One can give thanks for pleasant experiences, while another gives thanks to God for carrying them through and bolstering them and giving them strength during times of hardship.
Such gratitude, intentionally practiced, changes an individual's life, to be sure. And it also can change the character of a community of faith. When Christians in a community of faith practice gratitude, they come to worship, not just to get something out of worship, but they come to give thanks and praise to God. And the church's mission then becomes more than an ethical duty, it becomes the work of grateful hands and hearts. So when Jesus tells the one returning leper, "Go your way, your faith has made you well," this proclamation is no longer problematic, even in prayers before God, when they don't result in physical healing. "Your faith has made you well" is a description of a life of blessing for all of God's people as we go on our way with grateful hearts and rejoice and give thanks. For in giving thanks in all things, we find that indeed God is in all things. The basic Christian experience is gratitude to God for God's love in Jesus Christ and the accompanying hopeful confidence and wholeness and wellness that comes with us, regardless of our worldly circumstances. One commentary writer, and I'll close with this comment, says her two favorite prayers in the morning are, help me, God, and at bedtime, thank you, God. For me, it's that weekly ritual of standing and singing in my community of faith and sharing God's word. May our scriptures today on this Thanksgiving Sunday bless us all with an attitude of gratitude in our everyday living, so our Thanksgiving may turn into thanks living. And for that we say, thanks be to God. And today in our worship, we show our thankfulness and praise by singing a song from More Voices. It's a song of praise to the Maker. The thrush sings high in the tree. It's a song of praise to the Maker. The gray whale sings in the sea. Let us join our hearts as we sing that song of praise.
You.
Friends, when we like that lone leopard who returned giving thanks to God, we have an attitude of gratitude. Our giving then is not an ethical duty, but an act of gratefulness and thankfulness to God. And that's how we share our gifts through the mission and service with that same spirit. So let us now check into our link and see how it makes a difference. And also, we will sing our offertory music and then share our offertory prayer. Greetings, friends. In our minute for mission today, I want to take a moment to say that I know that at this time of year in Thanksgiving, it's a time when we give thanks to God for all the blessings that we have. A time when we in Newfoundland and Labrador can gather around tables and with family and loved ones, and we'll have an abundance of food. But we also must remember that there are folks in this time of food insecurity that won't gather with such an abundance that we have. And food is just not scarce, but there's also, it's incredibly costly. And according to the federal government, there was an average, I remember up north in Nunavut, about $1,000 a month for folks to put food on their table. And now that's gone up to $1,600 a month because of the cost of living and the cost of transportation. But we also know that there are folks who are homeless and those that are in need. So as we join around a table this Thanksgiving, I want you to know how grateful we are for your support. Your gifts to the mission and service extend far beyond your own table. And we're not just providing meals, folks. When we give to the mission and service, we're sharing the love and the compassion of our faith for those who need it most. So thank you for making a profound impact. And I want you to know we wish you a very blessed Thanksgiving.
What can I do?
What can I do?
What can I bring?
What can I bring?
What can I say?
What can I say?
What can I sing?
What can I sing?
I'll sing with joy.
I'll sing with joy.
I'll say a prayer.
I'll say a prayer.
I'll bring my love.
I'll bring my love.
I'll do my share.
Let us now share a prayer over our gifts. Loving and gracious God, we bring our gifts, our time, and our talents before you with thankful hearts. May our sharing help offer hope for the troubled, care for the lonely, and grace for those who need it. We pray with praise and thanksgiving in our hearts. Amen. And now let us prepare our hearts for prayer as we sing, Lord, listen to your children praying. Lord, send your spirit in this place.
Spirit in this place.
Let us now pray in silence for ourselves, our families, our church, and our community as we meditate upon what God has told us and even now telling us through God's still small voice. Let us pray. Gracious God, in and through your Son, Jesus, you bring us wholeness as we journey on our way, asking nothing from us but that we remember and give you thanks, and that gratitude be in our daily actions, and that in turn we offer you good gifts, gifts to those around us who are in need. And loving God, we thank you, and we praise you, and we prayerfully return to you in prayer. Like the Samaritan leper you healed, we give you gratitude. And so we come to you asking you to look upon us, the God who gives us all that we need, rather than the God who is able to give us what we really need. Teach us the wisdom that comes from looking at the world with a broader view than with our own desires. Help us not only to pray for our daily bread, but for your kingdom to come and your will to be done. A world where peace will reign, where catastrophes will be no more, where we will look after creation, the creation that you so freely have given us as a gift. Help us not only to pray for physical healing, but the ability to live abundantly in your Holy Spirit. And bless us with a life that is more than the humdrum of every day, to be aware of your goodness day to day, and to witness to your power and to see your good works and your love in all of our words and actions. Healer of our every ill, we pray today for all those who are afflicted by disease and hunger, by war and terrorism. We pray for all who are unjustly treated because of illnesses or differences. We pray for those who have no place to celebrate with family, the homeless, the uncared for, the rejected. For them, we pray that their needs will be met, and more, that they may also not only receive healing or food for their bodies, but that they may know the absence of fear that is replaced by peace and justice. May they come to know that every good and perfect gift comes from you, much more that they may be blessed as with any spiritual healing and any spiritual food that they may need. Give them the inner peace of your kingdom. Finally, Lord, we pray for ourselves and for those we lift before you today, for those deep within our hearts, for each one bowed in your presence, no matter where they may be, for seniors, for shut-ins, and all those under doctor's care. Loving God, hear our prayers of thanksgiving and intercession to you as we gratefully lift our prayers unto your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us when we pray together to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And for our closing hymn today, it's a wonderful old hymn of praise, How Great Thou Art. Let us join our hearts as we sing it together.
O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the mighty thunder, thy power throughout the
And before I share the commissioning, I want to thank you for joining us today. Thank our reader, thank our musicians, thank our technical crew, and thank all that makes this possible. And most of all, thanks to our loving God for giving us the opportunity and, you know, the wisdom and the technical skills, because all wisdom comes from God, to be able to offer this to you in your homes. And now let us share our commissioning, and it's printed together for you to share with me together. Let us go forth in peace, offering gratitude unto God, which can transform our common days into thankful living, and our daily routines into joy, and change ordinary opportunities into blessings. And now may the blessings of Creator God go with you and be seen in your life. May the love of Christ be your guide, and the power of the Holy Spirit fill your heart with a continual attitude of love toward all. God bless, and have a wonderful week until we gather again.